Good morning. Your Excellency, Madame Helen Clark, distinguished ambassadors and guests, dear students and faculty, it is my pleasure to welcome you all in ADA University for our regular series of global perspective lectures in the new academic year. As you know, this lecture series have become a unique platform for discussions on issues of global importance, and today we are honored to host a very accomplished global leader to talk about post-2015 sustainable development goals. Madame Clark has been serving as administrator of the United Nations Development Program since April 2009. She is the first woman to lead this organization. And I assume, Madame Clark, it's not going to be the last first in your future career. Madame Clark is also the chair of the United Nations Development Group, a committee consisting of the heads of all UN funds, programs, and departments working on the development issue. Prior to her appointment with UNDP, Helen Clark served for 9 years as Prime Minister of New Zealand for 3 successive terms between 1999 and 2008. Throughout her tenure as Prime Minister, Helen Clark engaged widely in policy development and advocacy across international, economic, social and cultural spheres. Under her leadership, New Zealand achieved significant economic growth, low level of unemployment, and high level of investment in education and health, and in the well-being of families and senior citizens. Helen Clark held various ministerial positions, served in Parliament for almost 2 decades, including chairing Parliament's Foreign Affairs Committee and taught in the Political Studies Department of the University of Auckland. She is still linked to academia via her husband, who is a professor at the same University of Auckland, and I hope she will feel at home today in our university as well. Madame Clark, once again, welcome to Baku and to ADA University. As Azerbaijan is making tremendous progress in economic and social development, the issue of human resources and investment into future generations is becoming more and more urgent. With that purpose, President Ilham Aliyev has established this new university several years ago and has been a generous supporter to our infrastructure developments and academic programs. You could not have chosen a better place in Azerbaijan to talk about sustainable development. I was truly impressed by your speech, Madame Clark, at the opening of the 4th Baku International Humanitarian Forum, where you praised the policy of our government to transform black gold into human gold, and mentioned that Azerbaijan is well placed to share its development experiences with other countries. Here at ADA University, we contribute to those efforts through granting international fellowship to foreign students whose geographic representation by now reaches more than 30 countries from Africa, Asia, and Americas. We also train foreign diplomats through specialized programs in our executive education school on topics like Caspian studies, energy, and governance. I'm happy ADA University gets a first-hand experience of interacting with you today, and look forward to your remarks. Thank you, and floor is yours, Madame Clark.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pashayev, for the introduction. Can I also acknowledge the permanent representative of Azerbaijan to the United Nations, our good colleague, the UNDP resident representative, Antonius Brook. I also have with me my regional director for Europe and the CIS, stand up, Shihan Sultanoglu. And greetings to faculty, students, and other visitors for today's lecture. And thank you to the Rector and ADA University for inviting me to come and speak today. And we've had, because there was so little traffic this morning, a good chance to look around the campus, having arrived very early. It's not so often one gets to design a new university from the very beginning, and what a beautiful university it is with its facilities. We really congratulate you on that. Who wouldn't want to study on such a campus? It's very, very nice. And I'm told that the university began its life with the objective of training students for diplomatic careers, and it still does that. But today it's offering a very wide range of courses across public and international affairs, the humanities and sciences, business and engineering, and ICT. So very well-rounded set of disciplines, and all important, of course, for building a diversified and sustainable economy and a cohesive society, and for enabling Azerbaijan to play its very constructive role in regional and global affairs. And I also note a number of international students are attracted to study here. Well, the topic we've given today's lecture is about moving from the Millennium Development Goals to a new set of global development priorities, which will be called the Sustainable Development Goals, yet to be fully defined. This agenda will be negotiated by diplomats in New York. So the post-2015 global development debate is really very relevant to everyone here who is aspiring to be a diplomat in Azerbaijan or in their own country. And of course, the future success of Azerbaijan and all countries is very closely linked to the state of the global economy, global ecosystems, and to the degree to which our world enjoys peace and security, which many don't at the moment. Development has a huge contribution to make across all these areas. Countries need economies which generate jobs and opportunities, especially for today's large youth generation, the largest the world has ever known, 1.8 billion adolescents and youth. And many, as you know, born into societies, both in developed and developing countries, where job and livelihood prospects are a little dim at the present time. Countries need societies which hang together, which are inclusive and cohesive. They need their ecosystems to be in good health. They need peace. And the development contribution runs across all these areas. So back in 2000, the UN member states got serious about having a prioritized global agenda for development. And for those of you who can remember back to the year 2000, apart from worrying about the Y2 bug and whether all the computer systems would crash, it was actually a time of great hope at the start of the new millennium, a hope that perhaps the 21st century would be a better century than the 20th century, which was a very bloody century, as those before it had been. And so in 2000, September, the Secretary General Kofi Annan invited heads of government and heads of state to all come to the UN in New York and sign up to the Millennium Declaration. And I went up there as a young Prime Minister from my country and put my signature on the Millennium Declaration. And the relevance of that is that in that declaration were contained most of the elements of what were later launched as the Millennium Development Goals. And these goals were embraced by countries around the world. They're embraced by developing countries. Many went to a great extent to write them into even a constitution, certainly into national development plans, and to measure and report against these goals and their targets and their indicators. And for the donor countries with official development assistance, many of them reoriented what they did around the global priorities set out in the MDGs. So perhaps a first point I'll make is that global agendas are important. If they're properly prioritised, they can get everybody kind of moving in the same direction. So the Millennium Development Goals, there were eight of them. They set out variously to tackle extreme poverty and hunger around the world, protect the environment, expand access to education, advance health status, gender equality, women's empowerment, and build global partnerships for development. And as I say, countries have taken them seriously, they've had strategies to achieve them, and mobilised external support around them. But here we are in late 2014, and these goals run their course at the end of 2015, which is well under 500 days to go. So as the debate about what follows next is well underway, we also need to look at, well, you know, what was achieved with the Millennium Development Goals and all the action and the focus, and what needs to carry over to the next agenda, but then what did the MDGs miss that the next agenda should pick up? So if we look at an area like the proportion of the world's people living in extreme poverty, the goal said eradicate extreme poverty, but the target said cut it in half. Well, the half was achieved 5 years ahead of target, according to the World Bank in 2010, which is great for the people who were lifted out of extreme poverty, but the half left behind has been left behind. That's unfinished business that needs to carry through. The target of halving the proportion of people who don't have access to improved drinking water sources has also been met. And on average around the world, we can say we've achieved gender parity between boys and girls in primary schooling, and most children now do enrol in primary schools, although how long they're there for and what they learn is another matter, and that needs to carry through to the next agenda too. Levels of infant and child mortality have decreased very, very significantly, and there's been a downward trend in three specified diseases which were targeted, malaria, tuberculosis, and HIV. HIV has been very challenging, but we can say that the tide has turned. However, and there's always a but, isn't there? The but is that the global trends and headlines of achievement do tend to cover up or disguise the very significant differences in achievements between countries and within countries. For example, when you look at the global target of cutting in half the proportion of people living in extreme poverty levels between the 1990 baseline date and 2015, the global success has been so overwhelmingly driven by what has happened in China, which has seen the most stunning movement out of extreme poverty any country has ever seen, hundreds and hundreds of millions of people. That drives the global average because of the scale of China. And sadly, some countries have seen very little reduction in their extreme poverty at all. And I'll come back and touch on reasons for that. In other countries where goals have been met on average, when you dig into the figures, you see quite significant gaps between those who've got there and those who haven't. Groups may be marginalized for a whole range of reasons in a country, maybe because they're female, maybe because they have disabilities, maybe a minority, whether ethnic, faith, indigenous people, and many reasons for marginalization. And marginalized groups tend not to have the same level of progress as the whole society. And then another area to point to particularly is the slower progress on the areas of dropping maternal mortality, mortality of women and pregnancy and childbirth, and the universal access to sexual and reproductive health. These goals have not done so well, and that points to ongoing challenges in getting equality between men and women and the empowerment of women. So here we are, you know, reasonably close to the end of the Millennium Development Goals, with still around a billion people being extremely poor, with the definition of under $1.25 a day. Many go to bed hungry and undernourished every night, and as you would expect, that has lifelong implications for children who don't have adequate nutrition in the earliest years. Lack of sanitation, this has also been a greatly lagging goal, leaves many people vulnerable to the rapid spread of disease, particularly in the aftermath of the increasingly frequent and severe natural disasters our world is experiencing. I remember being on a panel several years ago with the Minister of Rural Affairs in India, and he pulled his cell phone out of his pocket. He said, "What's wrong with us in India?" He said, "Almost everybody's got a cell phone and hardly anybody's got a toilet. What are our priorities?" he said. And it's a cause for reflection, obviously. Also in areas of challenge in the MDGs, you know, a number of the world's ecosystems are under very serious stress, and that threatens the ongoing supply of what we would broadly call ecosystem services, you know, as basic as water. We're under stress. So there is work to do on the next global development agenda to see that nobody's left behind in the progress we make on the next set of goals, whatever they are, and I will come to that, and that the pathway to lifting human development is a sustainable one and doesn't advance human beings at such expense to the environment that we start to undercut the basis for life on Earth. Now, from the experience of working with the MDGs, UNDP has drawn a number of conclusions about what helps countries to make fast progress. And the first point I'd underline is there is absolutely no substitute for visionary leadership and effective governance and strong national ownership of the development strategies. No development aid, no external actor can substitute for any of that. If there's not leadership, vision, governance, capacity to make it happen, it doesn't happen. So we really underline the importance of that. And as I said, the capacities. It's one thing to have a vision, a strategy, policies, a plan. It's another thing to have the capacity to make them happen. We are a capacity development organisation, so working to support countries to build the capacities to actually make things happen is very important to us. Of course, money is not unimportant. You know, funding is rather important for development. But looking to the future of development financing, the official development assistance will continue to play an important role, particularly for the low-income countries, but increasingly the official assistance from the traditional donors has to be much more catalytic, because it is now the minor part of what goes into development. The major part is coming from the growth of economies, the fact that developing countries with growth of economies have the money themselves to invest, and then the role of trade and investment and the volume of remittances coming into many countries, all of this is dwarfing the role of official development assistance. And finally, I'd underline in achieving development goals, the role of the subnational level of government is very important, the local governments, the private sector, and the civil society as well. So to come to where we go, from what we've had to what could be. For the most part, the Millennium Development Goal agenda was setting targets for developing countries to meet. There was Goal 8, which was a partnership goal, and it had in it indicators which, if reached, would support development, like reaching higher levels of official development assistance, having better trade rules. Well, that one's got a bit stuck, with the Doha round being very stuck at the WTO. Debt relief, and there's been quite a lot of debt relief, very significant debt relief. Access to affordable essential drugs was in the partnership goal, and access to new technologies, especially ICTs. And Azerbaijan's a very go-ahead country on ICTs. You're certainly playing your full role in that one. But the Sustainable Development Goals agenda is a much more transformational agenda than what I've just described. It is about encouraging a transition to sustainable economies and societies by all countries, while also focusing on what are the means of implementation for developing countries to make the transition to sustainability. In the discussions in New York, the member states have agreed that this post-2015 agenda should have a single framework and set of goals. It should be universal in nature, applicable to all countries, developed and developing, while taking account of differing national circumstances and respecting national policies. And they say, and I quote, from the outcome document of the leaders' level meeting on the MDGs in post-2015 September last year, it should promote peace and security, democratic governance, the rule of law, gender equality, and human rights for all. This is a pretty ambitious agenda, as you can see. Now, how do you start with such an agenda? Well, there's been a number of starting points. There's been formal processes. Secretary General had a high-level panel on post-2015, which produced quite a good report last May. The UN development system was strongly of the view that the discussion should go far beyond governments. Obviously, the views of governments are very important because they negotiate the agenda. But what did people think about it out around the world? And for that reason, we were able to facilitate very, very large-scale consultations around the world on what people thought a global agenda should look like. There were about 88 national consultations, and one of them was right here in Azerbaijan. Had very, very good participation. And in a way, when you have a global consultation about the future we want, it also becomes a proxy for, well, what do we want here? You know, so it sort of has that positive interplay with people thinking about their own country's development too. We had a lot of major thematic consultations on the environment, on health, on education, on inequalities, on the blight of conflict on development. All of this has been reported on back to the member states. And then we did the big online survey, which is still going for people who haven't gone into it. It's called My World. And it lists about 16 different areas and asks people, well, what would you prioritize in the new agenda? And believe it or not, we've had around 5 million people participate in the survey. So we're getting a bit of a feel for what the world's peoples are saying. The consultations here, there's been two rounds of them, and they've reached out very broadly. Women and men, young people, children, people with disabilities, the internally displaced people, academics, private sector, journalists, NGOs, rural areas and urban. And there's been a strong focus here on youth issues with a second round of consultations, which I understand worked with about 800 young people. And I think the Model UN workshop hosted here at the university might have had some role to play in that at all. So we're very grateful that Azerbaijan has got on board with the whole process and there's been very broad participation. I'm told that out of the consultation here, there were three areas identified as priorities. The need for economic diversification and inclusive growth, rural development and quality infrastructure, and enhanced quality of healthcare and access to healthcare. Those came out as three big areas. Now, around the world, the feedback was that the MDGs are still very important, and the unfinished business, which I spoke of before, the still high levels of extreme poverty, hunger, etc., need to be tackled. In country after country, and in this online voting in the survey, people have singled out education, health, and jobs as extremely important to them. Interestingly, after that, the next biggest priority tended to be a desire for honest and effective governance. I think there's a real, comprehension among the world's citizens that helps drive a positive development agenda as well. But interestingly, in the consultations, people have been very clear it's not just about numbers. It's not just about quantity in education or health or jobs. It's about quality as well. If you send your children to school, you'd like them to learn something. If you go to a health system, you'd like it to provide an effective treatment. If you're going to have a job, you'd like it to be decent work, poor quality work. So meeting this desire for better quality as well as quantity is quite important. And also there's been, you know, a lot of venting about the desire to live without fear of violence or conflict in societies which are fair, have good justice systems, and don't discriminate or exclude people because of their being from a minority or a group that's traditionally discriminated against. The consultations overall have been very supportive of keeping a big focus on the eradication of poverty in all its dimensions, but doing it in a way which doesn't compromise vital ecosystems. If we develop in a way which poisons our water, our oil, wrecks our climate, then we really haven't made a lot of progress. So, in terms of formal processes, the General Assembly put together an open working group of the Member States on Sustainable Development Goals, and it started meeting last year, and it's brought down a big report in July. This big report proposes 17 areas of goals and 169 targets. The report is building on the legacy of the MDGs, covering the unfinished business, but it's also broadening the scope with goals on inequalities, reduction, infrastructure, energy, peaceful and inclusive societies, and other new areas. It would be a universal agenda aiming to shift the world from the rather unsustainable consumption and production patterns we have to sustainable. We think at UNDP, working globally, as we do, in virtually every developing country and territory on Earth, that it will be important to prioritise addressing the factors which perpetuate underdevelopment and cause development setbacks. Increasingly, we see high levels of extreme poverty concentrated where a country's in conflict. Where the governance is poor, where the state is weak, where there is low social cohesion between communities, and often a high exposure to natural disasters as well. Think Somalia, and you will think across each of those factors. But those factors can also drive setbacks in states which have made considerable progress, but where there are underlying development weaknesses. And some of the worst conflicts we're seeing around our world at the moment are not in the poorest countries. Syria was a pretty solid middle-income country. Iraq, with its petroleum base, potential to be an upper middle-income country when stable. So underlying development deficits, which UNDP has been writing about in its Arab human development reports for about the last decade, point to some of the underlying issues which cause huge setbacks. And we say there are development solutions which can help build better governance, establish the rule of law and human rights, including women's rights, strengthen social cohesion and resilience to shocks, whether it's a natural disaster or the conditions that might lead to conflict, and build the capacities for countries and communities to mediate and resolve their tensions and differences peacefully. And we work around the world in all these areas, as well as on inclusive and sustainable growth. We also think that the new agenda will be most powerful if, like the MDGs, it is measurable, clear, and concise. That means we think that 17 areas of goals is rather too many, and the number of targets identified so far is rather too many. So we will be contributing to the Secretary-General's report, which is called a synthesis report, which the General Assembly has asked for. And we hope that that might be able to help to cluster and prioritise the agenda a bit more. Because I really have a concern if the UN, after these negotiations, comes out to developing countries and says, here's the global agenda with 17 priorities, the response might be, you're joking. Because it's very hard to have 17 priorities. Next July, there will be a conference on financing for sustainable development in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. This is going to be a pretty important conference, and I think it's one of those events before which you won't get much sign-off on the new development agenda, because people like to see the colour of the money, the colour of the partnership. Money is important, but compared to the Millennium Development Goals, I also think this new agenda is going to be much more about making policy choices which are positive for development, government policy choices which are positive for development. However, as I said before, the official development assistance will continue to be particularly important for the low-income countries, and for developing countries as a whole, the level of commitment from developed countries to ODA is a very important trust-building signal. For Azerbaijan, we can say that the outcomes of the post-2015 consultations here are broadly consistent with the priorities articulated in Azerbaijan's Vision 2020, which aims to move the country to a knowledge-based and diversified economy. And later this month, your country will be hosting the first ever Global Forum on Youth Policies. It's a partnership with the Office of the UN Secretary General's Youth Envoy, UNDP, UNESCO, and the Council of Europe. And we hope that the momentum out of this event in Baku will help set the global priorities for youth in the new agenda. I can also say that we're laying the groundwork for the next five-year cooperation plan between the UN development system and and Azerbaijan, and the priorities of the new agreement for 2016-2020 will be aligned with Azerbaijan's Vision 2020, with a focus on promoting sustainable employment, enhancing environmental management, strengthening resilience to disasters, which is already good, but we all have to keep lifting our game with the climate change phenomenon, and building local capacities to advance human development. We enjoy very strong partnerships here, and we think that Azerbaijan's in a very exciting period of its history, with big opportunities to share the many experiences, innovations, lessons learned from its own development, and support other countries to advance their goals. We know there is a reasonably new Azerbaijan International Development Agency, which we're very happy to work alongside and do more with through South-South cooperation. Rector, that's my summary on where we're at in this transition from MDGs to SDGs. We really thank Azerbaijan for entering so fulsomely into the process, and maybe in the time we have for interaction, we could hear from people or hear questions about what Azerbaijan's contribution to development and global priorities should be, and any ideas you have or suggestions on how Azerbaijan and UNDP can work together as champions of global development. Thank you very much.
Clark, it's really now, personally myself, I understand much better now. What's UNDP doing? Really, you touched upon what Azerbaijan's position now, overall up to now, what Azerbaijan did in this program. And I listened to you also yesterday, what you mentioned some couple of special programs you did with Azerbaijan, and Azerbaijan itself also contributed to development. And I think it's experience of Azerbaijan somehow might be very useful for implementation in some countries also. And Millennium Development Program now becoming after 2015 Sustainable Development Program. I understand that during these 15 years, this program started in 2000. During 15 years, you already accomplished a lot. And now world of sustainable. It's very close to our mind and our hearts here in Azerbaijan. For example, this new institution, we always in our discussions talking about how to make it sustainable, because government also, of course, can provide some initial investment to build some good buildings, but how to make it sustainable, it's a major issue. So it's for us a program which is adopted under leadership of President, this program of 2020. I think it's very much helping us to guide us in the right direction. So I think we will get some questions to you, and now it's floor open for questions, please. Yes, please.
I'm Shahin Panahov. I'm former UNDP employee and MDG focal point and sustainable development advisor. You mentioned in your speech that MDG 8 actually precondition for seven other MDGs to be achieved. And you also described, let's say, conducive environment that should be created by national governments, by national stakeholders. And one of key arguments, let's say, issues, it was commitment by developing countries to produce MDG reports. That makes clear what has been done, what should be done. But also there was commitment, and you described MDG 8 clearly all issues. And one commitment by developed countries to produce also their own MDG reports. How many MDG reports have been produced by developed countries? My question is about this one. I know that there was one from Denmark, and if I'm not wrong, but
I've never seen an MDG report from a developed country.
Thank you very much.
So what will change for the future with sustainable development goals is there for everybody.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, thank you for your speech. And I'm an international student from Kyrgyzstan here in ADA. And I worked in promoting my world survey in Kyrgyzstan back. And as we know that Millennium Development Goals mainly focus on the eradication of poverty, mainly in African continent. And you mentioned that this new post-2015 sustainable development goals will be focused, it will be applicable for all the countries. So, but when we gathered in Sri Lanka for the World Conference on Youth, when we talked about post-2015 sustainable development goals, the youth came to understand that in every continent, in all the countries, we have different problems, issues that need to be solved. But from your speech, I understand that it will be work in all the continents. So it will be the goals that suit all the problems. How are you gonna achieve this goal? And is it possible? If not, on what continent this time the main issues will be focused? As Millennium Development Goals mainly focus on Africa. And what do you think? What continent will be focused this time in the post-2015 development agenda? And is it possible to make all the issues around the world to one and applicable to all the countries? Thank you.
You know, with the MDGs, there were probably some developing countries that met virtually all of them at the time they were launched, and some that met none, and some that still met none. So there is, you know, obviously local context and conditions. There is, I think, an understanding with this new agenda that there'll probably be much more conscious adaptation to what can be achieved locally. For example, for some countries, there's still a gap to get every child into a primary school or every child completing a primary school. But I think the agenda will be more ambitious in saying that you know, the goal should be to get people through primary schooling and into the secondary schooling and then into ongoing training and education. That's going to be a very, very long stretch for the poorest countries, of course. but for the middle-income countries, developing their people skills and knowledge, what's sometimes called human capital, is going to be absolutely critical for getting out of the middle-income trap, because a lot of countries get trapped in middle-income and can't make that next step because the education system, the human development hasn't enabled that to happen. But there's definitely also the issue of quality. As I said, the access to primary education has spread very, very rapidly, but the quality hasn't expanded with the access. And there's been some quite disturbing studies looking at how much in a range of countries in Africa where I've seen these, how much a child has actually learned after 4 or 5 years at school, and they may still not be able to write or read or do basic mathematics. So the point of education is actually to learn something, not just to sit in front of a teacher with 70 or 80 other children and no curriculum resources and backup. So yeah, I think we have to be ambitious, but we have to recognise also that people start from different points, and that it's easier for some to get to here than for others. But then, you know, there needs to be more support for those who are starting from much, much further behind.
My name is Eldar. I am a student of ADA, first intake of EMBA class. My question is actually, first of all, thank you for your speech. Now for me personally, it's more clear what UNDP does in general and what goals for 2015 are. My question is about proactivity, probably, of this organization. I believe that you use some, probably, tools or your experience in order to address potential problems in countries. I believe that the goals for most of the countries are more or less same, similar at least. So, taking into account your experience, taking into account, all what this organization gained during all these years, what your strategy, your proactive strategy in the future in order to address all possible problems in the countries, for example, in Azerbaijan? Thank you.
Well, you know, our thinking is that there has been a lot of progress and development. There's a lot more growth in emerging economies in least developed countries. And countries are very, very ambitious. And the issue is, for me, not so much now the level of development assistance funding, which is irrelevant to Azerbaijan, because Azerbaijan is an emerging economy. It's got deep pockets. For me, I think the emphasis is shifting to more the currency of development being the currency of ideas, knowledge, innovation, experience sharing. And that's why I emphasized, particularly at the speech yesterday at the Humanitarian Forum, the importance of what Azerbaijan is thinking about in terms of its own development cooperation. Because this country has done some very exciting things in its pension system modernization. I mentioned it's one-stop shop. Public service hubs where in one place you can get your birth certificate, your permit, instead of having to run around 10 different offices and wait in long queues. You know, the use of ICT for provision of government services. There's a lot of innovative experience here. The disaster risk reduction has reached quite a high level. I was very impressed yesterday with what our discussion at the Ministry of Emergency Situations. But as I say, there's still work to do with climate change. You expect more extreme, unpredictable, and severe events. So what we used to prepare for, we have to prepare for with bells on, you know, more resilience. So many countries are very interested in what's happening here. How did you modernise this pension system so 99% of people got their money electronically, not having to queue at the local post office or whatever? How do you do these one-stop shops? How did you roll out this e-governance? You know, how did you build this level of resilience, to adverse events, disasters? So our job we see very much as helping share experiences, knowledge, and innovation. And the fact that we continue to operate in countries from the upper middle income, like your own, through to the poorest countries on earth, like Somalia and Mali and Burkina Faso, we've seen the whole range. And often what developing countries are looking for is not how it's done in New Zealand or the Netherlands, but how is it done in a country like mine? How did they deal with these challenges I'm dealing with now? And if you take the overall move to sustainable development, take a country like Ethiopia, which is one of the world's poorest countries, but with enormous potential. It's always had strong leadership and a clear vision. It's done quite well on the MDGs. We were part of their launch with their previous late Prime Minister of Ethiopia's low-carbon, climate-resilient green economy strategy. Now, if Ethiopia can think like that, any country can think like that. They're saying we want to lift the development of our people, but we don't want to do it by wrecking our environment. So we're going to have very deliberate strategy for this. And so then our role is not only in helping prepare the strategy, but then putting flesh on the bones. How will you do it? What needs to be done? Share experience. And then Ethiopia will look to how other countries have trod that road. But a lot of it is about, you know, sort of overcoming the barriers of being limited by our imagination. We're only limited by our imagination. So what is the best practice out there? How can we bring that to bear? And you know, we see our role in sharing experiences from elsewhere to here, but experiences from here to elsewhere as well.
Thank you. Yes, please, Sheikh Barman.
Thank you very much, Madam Clark. It was very insightful and very interesting discussion on the MDGs. I think one of the important parts of the success of MDGs was that it was pretty clear and concise and very straightforward. And it is a success. It is a success of the first globally coordinated policy around the world, and I really would like to commend the UN and UNDP in particular on this success. But this concisement of the goals is actually being a little bit lose when you are mentioning 17 priorities and 169 indicators, especially taking into account that the new SDGs are including the areas which are not straightforward, as let's say extreme poverty reduction, so for example governance or human rights or any other civil society engagement. These are very hard to put indicators on and to monitor. And monitoring is important because the countries are looking at MDGs and in the future at SDGs as lighthouses where they should move, and they need this measurement in order to move forward. So how do you see the process going on, going forward in terms of tackling this problem and trying to bring down the number of priorities, trying to make them more concise and put the measurable indicators so that the success of the MDGs were repeated? Thank you.
Could you present yourself?
I'm sorry. My name is Shahmar Mofsumov. I'm executive director of the State Oil Fund. Thank you.
Yes, well, we work on the basis if it can't be measured, it doesn't count, unfortunately. And the MDGs were measurable, and people did, you know, monitor and measure against that. So measurability has always been an important criterion for us. In terms of trying to get something more more compelling, I think when you look at these 17 proposed areas, there's a tremendous amount of duplication in them. The head of the Japanese International Cooperation Agency, JICA, came to see me several months ago. He said, "Helen, here's my list of getting it down to 6 goal areas." So I had a look at it and I said, "Well, you can't leave out the women," and there was something else you can't leave out, but you know, basically, you could, with goodwill, get to about 8 areas. So we're going to very much depend on the member states looking at this, and I hope that capitals will get engaged, because, you know, often in New York, you know, it has its sort of rhythm, and the rhythm can be a little bit divorced from the practical realities of what it takes to drive a development agenda and economic and social progress and environmental sustainability at home. So I really urge that capitals take a close a close interest. The Secretary General's report, we hope, will be helpful in saying, well, maybe here's how it could be synthesised and clustered. You know, I mean, what's plan B if we end up with 17 goal areas and 160 targets? The UN will have to then come up with some kind of communication strategy which simplifies it and presents it to countries in a digestible way. But I'd prefer not to have to go to plan B. I'd prefer to have plan A. Thank you.
Thank you. Now it's international students there.
Hi.
Yes, please.
Good morning.
Come forward, please. Okay.
My name is Nyakairo. I'm from Kenya. We have a UNDP there, so I'm well versed with the MDGs. I'm just wondering how feasible are the SDGs? Because the MDGs so far have only been covered in a few countries, like only a few have achieved them. So why move on to SDGs when you still have so much to do with the MDGs? Again, what will be the quality? Because as you just said, measurability was one of the issues that you had to cover with the MDGs. However, if 1,000 people go to school and only one person learns, then you've done nothing. So how will you measure the quality? Also, I wanted to know if you've encompassed things like terrorism, Ebola into your plans, because they have a spillover effect into the goals. So how will you combat like such things? For example, like now Ebola has become a big issue. If you're going to deal with health, I suppose you need to look forward to such things. Thank you.
I think the important thing about global goals, if they can set clear priorities, is it does influence then national priorities. So you know, countries do take this seriously. And if there's clear emphasis coming through on, say, education, that, okay, we've been pretty successful in getting close to most children, and I say most children, very high proportion of the world's children in school, but now we've got to go to the next step and invest in the teacher training and the curriculum and the learning environment. Countries will take this to heart and say, yes, okay, we've got to here, but now we've got to raise our sights. So these agendas are also about empowering countries to move in that direction. It's not something anybody's going to do for somebody, but it's really about saying, well, where are things going here and how do we get on board with that? I mean, I think that, you know, demonstrably, there has been far faster progress in the areas identified for health and education in the MDGs than would have been seen without them, because they were clear priorities. You know, I mean, there are still in the world about 60 million children who are not enrolled in school, but that's a fraction of what it was. And sometimes I go to a very poor country like Burkina Faso, where I was in 2010, and you look at MDG progress on education, and you see, 66% of the children in school. Well, clearly there's a third that aren't in school. But then you look at the adult literacy rate, which is 28%. So actually 66% is a triumph for Burkina Faso, and we have to build on that success and support the country to go to the last mile. So if you look at the health goals, the rate of reduction in avoidable mortality in these areas targeted, like infant and child rates, maternal mortality rates, HIV, TB, malaria, is far faster than any trend observed before the MDGs, because there was a lot of focus on these areas. A lot of money went into these areas, countries' own money, donor money into this. I mean, if you take HIV, the spread of medication to people living with HIV has been absolutely phenomenal. In low-income countries, there was very little access before. Now, still a way to go, but there has been progress. So I think it's all about, the global discussion then leading to a clear set of priorities which will inspire countries to lift their sights, lift their game, move in a certain direction. Now, of course, you mentioned something like Ebola. where has Ebola broken out and where is it devastating communities and economies? In three of the poorest countries on Earth. It is a problem of underdevelopment, lack of capacity in the health system, poverty, ignorance, you know. I mean, people in some cases have turned on the health workers, have come, health workers have been killed in one country because they're accused of spreading the disease. So, you know, actually what has happened with Ebola is a function of multidimensional poverty. It brings us back to a focus on eradicating extreme poverty, education, basic primary health care capacity. We need to see it in that context. Terrorism's a lot tougher. And it's not as simple as just saying that this is an outgrowth of poverty, because you then can't explain how people come out of, you know, professional jobs in developed countries and go and join a group that's going to, you know, wage a pretty nasty sort of conflict. But there's also always a context to that as well. You know, would the conflict in Syria be where it is today if in those early days of peaceful demonstrations there'd been a different attitude towards change? You know, we've seen such a wide range of reactions to demands for change, some accommodative, and so there's a dialogue with society, a process of constitutional change, others complete eruptions and chaos. And the Syria path, unfortunately, has been the latter one, and it's not easy to see an end to it yet. But we do think that in this area of goals identified by the UN Member State Working Group around peaceful, inclusive societies, there's a lot of insight in that. That for development to be sustained, you do need peace. No peace without development, no development without peace. It's very, very interlocked. If you look at the countries that end up on the Security Council agenda, which are in a terrible state of conflict, there's always a development deficit somewhere in there, which could be addressed proactively.
Thank you, Ambassador, saying me that Madam Clark has time for one more question. Maybe yes, Sura.
Thank you very much. Madam Clark, good afternoon. It's a great honor for us to welcome you at the university. And my question would be about gender equality. As you probably know, Azerbaijan was the first Muslim country to give the voting right to women. And it was back in the 1980s, the beginning of the 20th century. And there is a lot of change in the Middle East going right now. So how do you think how Azerbaijan can input and whether it can play a role model in the promotion of the women equality issues and raising the importance and the influence of women in the Middle East region and in the whole, in the West, in the Muslim world? Thank you.
Well, I think there can be enormous experience sharing out of Azerbaijan. A country where most people adhere to the Muslim religion, a modern progressive country with a very good legislative framework around women's rights. Very good framework. Now, you know, still issues to address, the participation of women in the parliament, the levels are quite low. I think there's been quite an effort at the municipal level and the numbers have come up there. But the legal framework's good. So it can be a very, very powerful role model, in my opinion. And, you know, again, it's an area where we should think of how to share experience. When I was in Georgia in the last couple of days, there's an interest there in convening a meeting which would share experience across Azerbaijan, Georgia, and, you know, possibly some others, and we'd really get in behind that because we think it would help inspire the women leaders to make their voice heard. So congratulations on being the first such country where women got the right to vote. I should put up a flag for my own little country, New Zealand. First country in the world where women fought for and gained the right to vote in 1893.
Okay. Madam Clark, we are at the ADA University, we are preparing future parliamentarians.
Yes.
So, Mr. Ambassador, I see some people wants to ask questions. Do we have time for one more question? One more question. Yes, please.
Hello, I'm Shalala Valieva. I'm junior diplomat and participant of Advanced Foreign Service Program 2014. That's, we know that UNDP has been working in Azerbaijan for 20 years, and also the supports Azerbaijan government in some in the sustainable development and active issue and very active in issues women rights and youth development, and also they are providing a lot of projects in Azerbaijan. And I would want to know that about the, your major expectation in post 2015 that as regard in terms of the project implementations. Thank you very much.
Well, we look at, you know, in discussing with the government what the shape of the program will be, we look at where UNDP can add some value. We have very strong relationships with a number of ministries. The Ministry of Communications and High Technologies, very go-ahead ministry, with a big role to play, I think, in the ongoing modernization of public administration and services. I'm happy to keep working alongside that and the whole e-governance agenda. Disaster risk reduction, as I say, is really quite advanced here now, but continuing to work with Azerbaijan as it forecasts what more it might have to deal with climate change. We've actually got quite an interesting project with the Ministry